We're talking about this book that Paul writes in the year 62 AD. It's a book that he writes then, but he had started this church 10 years before, this church in Philippi, and he is now in the Mamertine prison, and things are looking quite bleak for him. A crazy emperor by the name of Nero is running the world at the time, and it's very likely Paul knows that he will die in the next couple of years, and yet he writes one of the most uplifting, cheerful, hopeful, powerful books. It leaps off the page even in the year 2018, just 2,000 years later. It is so encouraging. And so the first week we talked about how God doesn't just use our successes, but God uses our failures, our hardships. And we saw that the life with God is like the kingdom, a river. It flows from the beginning of time to the end of time, and that God rushes forwards with his power and his river, which takes our failures, our hardships. And we saw that as like our rocks, our trees, our couches, our fridges that go down that river, and God carries them through to the end. And then a couple weeks ago was Mother's Day, and we talked about just the importance of harmunity, or the harmony of unity, and that comes from humility. And we saw that our world needs more of harmony, and we've seen a lot more people driving with two fingers on their steering wheel, giving each other the Burlingame wave as they pass. And so that's been good. And God doesn't want us to think less of ourselves, but to think of ourselves less. And then last week, we talked about the power of words. That as people who were created just beneath the angels, as very good that God created us to be able to create, and that these things that come out of our mouths are not just verbs and subjects and consonants and predicates, that they are creation tools, and that we get to create or we get to destroy as humans. And we saw the power of the words that we speak. So today, on this Memorial Day weekend, what I want to offer is a message which I have been brooding about all week in my heart. And I think the reason I have been is because I think it is in some ways one of the most challenging ideas for us who live in a place like Burlingame. And that is the idea that God can actually use our mediocre performances more than he can use our so-called successes. So we talked about failures and successes. God can use failures. But this is perhaps even a bigger idea, that God can use our B game more than he can use our A game. And so I want you to think about your life. I want you to think about something that you've been proud of for a while, like a big success that you had. And I also want you to think about something that you feel like you're going through your life, just going through the motion, just giving your B game, giving it a mediocre performance for. And you know, maybe that's your parenting, or maybe that's your work, professional life, or maybe it's your marriage or so. But I want us to think about that. And I want us to see how God can use that. And so let's begin with prayer, and then let's talk about it. Father in heaven, we come to you as people who live in a town in which the very best is expected of us all the time. The very best is expected of us at work. The very best is expected of us at school. The very best. And we have told ourselves that unless we're the very best, that somehow you can't use our lives. And Lord, over the next few moments, I pray that you would use this message to turn that idea on its head. That, Lord, you can use all that we give you. And that perhaps you even can appreciate our B game more than our A game. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So this very auspicious looking trophy that you see on this stool here is a trophy that I won when I was 18 years old. And so I'm turning 46 this weekend, and so that means I won that 28 years ago. I won it for the National Oratory Championship, and by the way, the finals was right here at San Jose State, right in the auditorium there. And so, 28 years ago, I won this thing, and it's been in my life for 28 years. It's actually been in our whole family's life. It's everywhere that we go, this thing comes with us. We've actually moved like 12 to 15 times, and 12 to 15 times I have packed up this relic. It used to have handles on the side of it, and it used to be shinier, and the front used to be that direction, but I mean, the problem is it doesn't even really go with anything in the house, you know? I mean, unless you're into like Greco-Roman Rococo art, you know? It doesn't go with the rest of our IKEA furniture, honestly. And Star's been trying to get rid of the thing for years, and I mean, who can blame her? I don't even remember the speech that I gave to get that award. When I look at pictures of myself when I was 18, I'm not even the same person anymore. It's like a different cellular structure that I look at myself and see. So here's the question. Why do I still have this trophy? Why do I carry it around with me wherever I go? And I guess the reason is because it was an example of what I think of as my A game, of when I won something, of when I was the victor. And I guess what I think inside is that if I don't bring my A game to everything I do, then somehow I won't measure up. That if I don't bring my A game to my preaching, to my teaching, to my pastoring, to my parenting, to my husbanding, to all those things, then somehow it's just not going to be good enough. And I bet that if we went around the room right now, we would find that I'm not the only one who has collected a few of these things in your life. I mean, maybe you're not packing it up, carrying it with you like I am, but maybe you are. You know, there are PTA presidents in the room, there are magna cum laudes, there are people who have degrees from esteemed universities, there are people who have been salesperson of the year or top of your law school. I bet if we went around the room, we would find out that a lot of people here have a lot of these things. I mean, because let's face it, you can't live in Burlingame if you bring your B game. You gotta bring your A game to live in B game. What's interesting is I've thought about my life. I've given a lot of speeches since this time, and a lot of them have been a lot more mediocre. But in some ways, those talks have been a lot more memorable. I mean, I remember a time that I was giving a talk at a nursing home about maybe 10 years ago, and I love speaking in nursing homes because, you know, it's a captive audience. They don't have a whole lot of other places to go. It's like prison ministry, you know, you're kind of there, you know. And I remember I was giving this talk, and it really wasn't going all that well, but I knew it was going really badly when I was trying to come up with the name of the dictator from Cuba, and I just was blanking. I couldn't come up with his name. And a 99-year-old woman in the back, she raised her hand and she said, "Do you mean Fidel Castro?" And I just knew that I wasn't bringing my A game that day. If a 99-year-old woman was coming up with what I should say. And the funny thing is, I've been back to that nursing home many, many more times because my grandma lives there, which makes it even more captive audience. I mean, she paid everyone to be there, basically. I mean, wherever I come in, they're like, "Hey, it's not the kid who doesn't know the dictator of Cuba. Can you get you a Cuban cigar?" I mean, they're talking about that. They're talking about that talk a lot more than anyone's talked about this so-called A game, except for me, 28 years later. And I'll talk about it in one more service right after this. What's interesting is a lot of the things that we think are like are really great performances, other people don't think are all that great. I'll just take a couple of examples. Anyone know C.S. Lewis here, the great author C.S. Lewis? Let me just get a show of hands. How many of you have read this book, A Preface to Paradise Lost? Anyone? Nobody? Oh, one? Very good. And how many here have read The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe? Pretty much everyone. Now, A Paradise Lost, or a preface to it, was considered by C.S. Lewis to be his great work. But only one person, and I want to talk to you after the service, that's quite impressive, has ever read that book. But everyone's read his B game, The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. He wrote that actually as an afterthought, a children's story. Here's another one, Leonardo da Vinci, great author. How many of you are a painter and artist? How many of you are familiar with the work, The Virgin of the Rocks? Anyone? Three? Okay, see me afterwards, very good, you get a prize. And what about the Mona Lisa? Anyone? The Mona Lisa was an afterthought by Leonardo. It was a painting of a housewife. And it's one of the most famous paintings in the world. Ernest Hemingway. We all know the author Ernest Hemingway. How many have read 3 stories and 10 poems? Anyone? And how many have read The Old Man and the Sea? The Old Man and the Sea was written in 1951, just after he got back from vacation. He just quickly put that story down in like a day or two. But nobody has read 3 stories and 10 poems, but he spent years on that first publication. Here's one more one for you. This may hit close to home. What about the Warriors? Stephen Curry. How many people liked game 2 in which we lost and Stephen Curry scored 16 points? Anyone? And how many people preferred game 3 in which we won by 41 points and he scored 35 points? Anybody here? Indeed. What's interesting is Stephen Curry said that he put a whole lot more into game 2, that was his A game. That game 3, where he scored 35 points, that was sort of just his afterthought. I'm going to pray for more of his B games tomorrow. So in the first century in Israel, in Jerusalem, a person's A game was not determined about how great their work of art was, or their writing was, or their degrees were, or which university they went to, or which part of town they lived in. Their A game was determined by how righteous they were. And if they were righteous, if they held to the law, if they held to the Ten Commandments, the Torah, the Levitical codes, then they had the equivalent of a national oratory championship. They had a trophy. That was their A game. And everybody walked around town trying to prove to the other people around them that they were more of an A person than the other people. Which, by the way, is one reason Jesus talks about hypocrites so much, which again comes to the Greek word hypokrites, which means to critique underneath. Because very often you find the people who think they're all that great are really just critiquing other people. So one of the marks of whether you were righteous or not is a little weird, but it was whether you were circumcised or not. And then there was this whole gradation of if you were circumcised on which day, which rabbi, which synagogue. And if you weren't circumcised, and of course that only applied to half the population, then they were willing to oblige and help you out with a dull instrument. And it would be a painful and silly process of getting a championship. And so this is the word that Paul has for us in this book of Philippians about A games and B games. He says this, "Furthermore, my brothers and sisters, rejoice in the Lord." He's already said it 12 times, and now in case we didn't get it, he's saying it one more time, "Rejoice in the Lord." "It is no trouble," he says, "for me to write these same things to you again, and it is a safeguard for you." Notice spiritual health is connected to our joyfulness. Think about that. The amount of spiritual health you have is related to how joyful you are. So he continues. "Watch out," he says, "for those dogs, those evildoers, those mutilators of the flesh, those who are walking around with trophies of righteousness. For it is we, who," he says, "who are the circumcision. We who serve God by the Spirit, who boast in Christ Jesus, who put no confidence in our trophies, in our flesh. Though," he says, "if anyone has right to boast, it's me." He says, "if someone else thinks that they have reason to put confidence in their trophies, I have way more." He says, "I was circumcised on the 8th day," which again means nothing to us, but the 8th day is the perfect day. The 7th day, of course, was the Sabbath. You couldn't do anything on the 7th day, but the 8th day was the next day. It was the most important day. He says, "Also, I was born of the people of Israel and the tribe of Benjamin, the perfect tribe." And we don't have time to dig into this much, but it was perfect partly because Benjamin was the youngest son, remember, of Jacob, of Israel. And remember, the youngest son was Rachel, was the wife, and Rachel was the A wife. Leah was the B wife. So all the kids that were born to Leah were not like up to the mark, but Rachel's kids were the best, and Benjamin was Rachel's kid, and so he came from the A tribe. In regard to the law, he said, "A Pharisee is for zeal, persecuting the church. As for righteousness," he says, "I'm faultless." Apostle Paul didn't just get the national oratory championship or the national righteousness championship, he got the global championship. He beat everybody. But he says, "Whatever were gains to me, I now consider a loss for Christ. What is more," he said, "I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things." He'd given up his trophies a long time ago. He goes on to say, I consider them garbage. Garbage? That degree from Stanford? That top of my class at Berkeley? That National Oratory Championship? Garbage? I got one more service, I better pull that out. Garbage. Those things are garbage. Compared, he says, to the faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from God on the basis of faith. I want to know Christ, he says. Yes, to know the power of his resurrection and the participation and the sufferings, becoming like him on this in his death, so that somehow attaining to the resurrection of the dead. In the place of his worldly trophies, Paul puts down the real trophy, the prize of Christ. But he says quite powerfully, not that I've even come close to attaining this, or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on, he says, to take hold of that which is take hold of me. Brothers and sisters, I don't even consider myself to have yet taken hold of it, but one thing I do, he says, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press on to the goal, to the prize that is found in Christ Jesus. What's quite powerful is that Paul gave up his so-called A game in the world to take on the game of following Christ, of which he says, I will only ever be a B student. I'll never become what I need to be in Christ. But I will always reach for that goal, that prize, which God has called me heavenward to in Christ Jesus. And that's the optimistic story for us. That not only can God use our B efforts, but that God prefers that we leave behind our trophies and follow the real prize in Christ. Now I know, it is beyond comprehension, this idea from Paul, because we live in this world that's always pressing us to do more, to be more successful, to succeed more. But the people that I have really had as my heroes in this life are the people who gave up this and sought after this. And you will find so many of those people around. You'll find people like that in this church. And you will find people like that in history. One of my favorites, of course, is Eric Little, who was a pastor. And you remember the movie Chariots of Fire, where in 1924 he wins the gold medal in Paris, the gold medal. And he could have kept running. In fact, his trainers wanted him to keep running and winning more gold medals. And running actually gave him a lot of joy. He said, of course, to his sister, Jenny, I believe the Lord made me for the purpose. He made me for the mission, but he also made me fast and want to run and feel his pleasure. But he gave it up in order to move to China to work as a Christian missionary and to die there in a concentration camp not long thereafter. He gave up all of this so that he could strive after this. And there are people in this world like this. One of the great professors of all time, a professor I had at Princeton named Dr. James Loder, who, if you know Kim Engelman, wonderful preacher, it's her father, who was the professor of professors at Princeton. Beth Frickberg wrote her PhD thesis with him, and without this professor, she may not have done all that she did with her life. Now, Dr. James Loder got a PhD in the history of religions from Harvard University. He could have taught anywhere. And yet he went from there to teach at Talbot Theological Seminary, to teach young seminarians. And then he wondered about going to Princeton because he wondered whether, you know, that might actually be too much of a trophy. So they had to twist his arm to get him there. And the list goes on and on. Thomas Merton was a man who was born to great wealth, great success, great lineage. And he gave it all up to become a Trappist monk in Kentucky. Or Simone Weil, who was born in Paris. And she was one of the great minds of her time. She grew up in a family where she could have done anything, and she gave all of that up to serve people in the Spanish Civil War, to just serve as a cook if they wouldn't let her do anything else. And on this Memorial Day weekend, we need to remember the thousands of men and women who could have been great, gave up their lives in foreign places so that we could be here today. And I just love people who are willing to just give their B game, knowing that their B game for Christ is better than their A game in the world. One of my favorite stories about this is a preacher, one of the greatest preachers named Bob Mitchell, who you may have heard of. He was president of Young Life International, and he brought thousands of young people to Christ. But when I got to know him in Colorado, he was 91, and I asked him to preach one Sunday. And he said, you know, I'm too old to preach. I can't do it. I can't even read my Bible anymore. I can't memorize my talks the way I used to. And I said, Bob, just come. So we built a ramp that day because he couldn't get up the steps to the pulpit. So we built a ramp, and honestly, we were wondering whether it was a good idea as he tottered his way up the ramp to get to the pulpit. But as he stood there, and he said, ladies and gentlemen, my name is Bob Mitchell, and it's an honor to be standing here today. And at my age, it's a miracle just to be standing at all. And gave a talk that I will never forget, because he was willing to give his B game that day. And, you know, we're building a great church here, but I know one of the challenges for many of you who bring your A game everywhere else is you say, you know, I'm not going to get involved at Pearl Press because I could only come if I could bring my A game to the band, A game to the session, A game to the volunteer, A game to the children's ministries. So I'm not going to do anything. But the history of our faith is people who are just willing to do their best for Christ. And Christ has the power to turn that into something. So just three thoughts on this Memorial Day weekend as you think about this. Number one, remember that your A game really isn't all that good. Sorry, I'm ripping the scab off. It's not. There's a funny book out there now called You're Not as Great as You Think You Are, A Demotivational Guide. So, and one of the credits of this book says this book turned me from a winner into a wiener in one sitting. It works. Here are some of the chapter titles: Chicken Coops for the Soul, Limiting the Power of Your Imagination, The Power of Negative Thinking, Giant Steps Backwards, The Art of Setting Self-Defeating Goals, Dare to Whine, The Road Not Taken, The Hidden Wisdom in Indecision and Procrastination. I'm not trying to demotivate you. God wants you to do what you're called to do. But to remind you that no matter how good your A game is, it's not as good as we think it is. And that too, God can actually use our B game more. He can use our average efforts. And there's a whole lot of reasons for this. Part of it is we put so much ego into this game, so much of ourselves. And so at the end of the day, we really look at the trophies that are really a reflection of who we are, but with our B game, God can put more of himself into that. And so many of our church hymns reflect this great theology. One hymn that never, ever gets used or sung at Christmas time, because it's about bleakness and winter, is called In the Bleak Midwinter. And but it's got beautiful words that I just want to lift up for you now as you think about your B game and what you might bring to God. And to remember that the woman who wrote this, Emily Dickinson, said that this was actually bad poetry. It was an example of her B game. But she reflects on this: what can I give him? Poor as I am. If I were a shepherd, I would bring a lamb. If I were a wise man, I would do my part. But what should I give him? I guess I'll give my heart. God wants you to just give that. And the last thing to remember is this: God gave his A game so that you don't have to. There's never been a better preacher than Jesus Christ. There's never been a better teacher. There's never been a better musician. There's never been a better ethicist. There's never been a better doctor. There's never been a more holy prophet. There's never been a kinder person, a more sympathetic person, a more loving person. There's never been a better friend. Why did he bring his A game for us? can do whatever we have, or whatever we can give to that. Amen?
Amen.
God, we thank you for living the A game. And pray, Lord, that as we live in a society, in a community that just seems to only settle for the best,